reason I wanted to create Neuralink was primarily as an offset to the existential risk associated with artificial intelligence. I think we will, human intelligence will be not, I mean, we will not be able to beat AI. So then, if you know, as the saying goes, if you can't beat him, join him, kind of thing. So I think having some basically finding a way to link human will en masse to the outcome of AI, having AI be an extension of individual human will, that's really the point of Neuralink. Now, along the way, I think there'll be a lot of good that's achieved in addressing any brain damage that's, you know, as a result of a stroke or a lesion or something congenital, or just, you know, loss of memory when you get old, that kind of thing. You know, that'll happen well before it becomes a sort of, brain AI symbiote situation. So we plan, you'll see it coming. It won't happen all of a sudden. But yeah, I do think it increases the long-term relevance of human exploration. I think it's for me it increased my motivation long-term that it doesn't just need to be done by robots.
Yeah. Working on AI and making sure it's a great future, that's the most important thing, I think, right now, the most pressing item. Obviously, anything to do with genetics, if you can actually solve genetic diseases, if you can prevent dementia or Alzheimer's or something like that, with genetic reprogramming, that would be wonderful. So I think this genetics, it might be the sort of second most important item. I think having a high bandwidth interface to the brain, like we're currently bandwidth limited. We have a digital tertiary self in the form of our email capabilities, our computers, phones, applications. We're effectively superhuman, but we're extremely bandwidth constrained in that interface between the cortex and your sort of that tertiary digital form of yourself, and helping solve that bandwidth constraint would be, I think, very important for the future as well.
What is a world that we would like to be in where there is this digital superintelligence? I think the and then another point that I think is really important to appreciate is that we are, all of us already are cyborgs. So you have a machine extension of yourself in the form of your phone and your computer and all your applications. You are already superhuman. But by far, you have more power, more capability than the President of the United States had 30 years ago. If you have an internet link, you have an oracle of wisdom. You can communicate to millions of people. You can communicate to the rest of Earth instantly. I mean, these are magical powers. That didn't exist not that long ago. So everyone is already superhuman and a cyborg. The limitation is one of bandwidth. So we're bandwidth constrained, particularly on output. Our input is much better, but our output is extremely slow. If you want to be generous, you could say maybe it's a few hundred bits per second or a kilobit or something like that output. The way we output is like we have our little meat sticks that we move very slowly and push buttons or tap a little screen. And that's just extremely slow. Compare that to a computer which can communicate at the terabit level. These are very big orders of magnitude differences. Our input is much better because of vision. But even that could be enhanced significantly. I think that the two things that are needed for a future that we would look at and conclude is good, most likely, is we have to solve that bandwidth constraint with a direct neural interface. I think a high bandwidth interface to the cortex. so that we can have a digital tertiary layer that's more fully symbiotic with the rest of us. Like we've got the cortex and the limbic system, which seem to work together pretty well. They've got good bandwidth, whereas the bandwidth to our digital tertiary layer is weak. So I think it's extremely important that it be widespread and that we solve the bandwidth issue. And if we do those things, then it will be tied to our consciousness, tied to our will, tied to the sum of individual human will, and everyone would have it. So it would be sort of still a relatively even playing field. In fact, it would be probably more egalitarian than today.
One of the solutions is to have an AI layer. If you think of, like, you've got your limbic system, your cortex, and then digital layer, sort of a third layer above the cortex, that could work well and symbiotically with you.
Of course, turning humans into cyborgs may sound like the stuff of science fiction, but then again, that is Elon Musk's forte. So would he develop this kind of technology himself?
Somebody's got to do it. I'm not saying that I will, but somebody's got to do it. Somebody should do it. And I mean, if somebody doesn't do it, then I think I should probably do it.
We do know that it's called Neuralink. And for more, we are joined by science journalist and futurist George Dvorsky, who has been covering this for Gizmodo. George Dvorsky is in Oakville, Ontario. Hello.
Hello. Thanks for having me this morning.
So what are you expecting Elon Musk to announce later this week?
Well, I certainly expect some more details. Right now, the so-called Neuralink is quite vague in terms of what this is supposed to look like, what it's even supposed to do, aside, of course, from some of the comments that Musk has made in recent months. Specifically, though, what I am expecting to hear, though, will be, I guess, the initial approach towards achieving this, you know, these chips that will be implanted in our brain and what we hope to accomplish with them. Initially, it's quite conceivable that Neuralink will be working not to enhance or to even, you know, add AI to our brains initially, but to actually become therapeutic. These same technologies can be used to treat, say, Alzheimer's or Parkinson's or even seizures, for example. And I think that's a good pathway into this particular area. But knowing Musk, of course, and knowing the kinds of visions that he has, he's not going to be content to stop there. And with the same sorts of technologies, you can now start to perhaps modify other aspects of cognition, things like memory and intelligence, even, for example, transmitting thoughts to and from a computer. Just thinking about it, you could transmit your memories and your thoughts to a computer. It's difficult to say if Musk will get to that level of specificity in his comments later this week, but that's certainly I'll be looking out for this week.
Well, George, that his venture is to develop something called NeuroLace. Can you help us picture what that is?
Because he used the word lace there, I'm imagining that it is going to be a kind of mesh that will be overlaid over certain parts of the brain. As we know, the brain isn't just this big piece of mush that does everything and anything everywhere. Our brains are broken down into different modules. So, for example, if you put this mesh area around the motor cortex, the area that controls movement, then this lace would pick up those signals. When we say, for example, I want to move my finger or I'd like to move my leg, the lace will pick up those signals and it will then transmit those signals, I would hope, wirelessly, because no one wants to have wires sticking out of their heads. And we already do have chips in animal models, for example, that can transmit wireless signals to a receiving device, namely a computer, hence which is why we're using the word interface here. So it basically would look like that, kind of a mesh. If not a mesh, or the lace could also conceivably be a literal chip, a literal brain chip that, set again, rests at a specific area of the brain.
Well, we're talking about something surgically implanted, though, eventually.
Absolutely. In order to get the kind of fidelity, the kind of the power of the signals to move, let's say, an artificial arm or to even transmit our thoughts, we're going to have to get right there into the brain. I mean, we do have what are called EEG technologies today, which is like a cap you can wear on your head. But the amount of information that can be extracted just through your electrical signals externally is extremely minimal. You might be able to make a gesture like you're thinking of moving to the left or you're thinking of moving to the right. But no, if you want to get down to the levels that Musk is talking about, we've got to get right into the brain itself.
Well, you know, we've got somebody waiting in the wings who's already using technology where the brain can control a limb through, or the brain can control movement of a machine. So what would be different with this technology? What would he really want to use it for?
Well, I mean, he wants to save the world, apparently. And I mean, right now, as I mentioned earlier, there's going to be a therapeutic aspect to it. That's going to be wonderful. And he has listed this company as a medical firm. So they are going to be producing medical devices at first. And of course, this is a multi-million dollar industry. So he knows what he's doing by, you know, becoming one of the first to market here. But as Musk has said, you know, artificial intelligence is progressing rapidly, and we're getting to the day, maybe 20 years from now, maybe 50 years from now, but we will get there eventually when artificial intelligence exceeds human capacities in virtually every way. And Musk's solution is an interesting one. He's not the first to suggest this. Other futurists have also suggested this, is that the best way for us to be able to control and contain our artificial intelligence is that if you can't beat them, join them mentality, and we will merge with our machines. So the idea here that he literally believes that we can kind of save ourselves from perhaps subjugation or some kind of an artificial intelligence disaster by augmenting ourselves along with our artificial intelligence, and that way we can kind of keep up with them should anything go askew in the future.
Do you see any resistance to this as he goes forward?
Most certainly. I mean, as I'm sure that your listeners are aware, that this issue is fraught with ethical difficulties. Everything from how do you find test subjects who are willing to have chips implanted into their brain or these meshes implanted into their brain? What kind of levels of consent can you get? I mean, at this point, are humans being treated as a means to an end in order to, let's say, stave off the threats posed by artificial intelligence? What kind of animal testing would be required, you know, through these kinds of experiments? And of course, there's the broader, more philosophical question as to what this means to our humanity. What does it mean to us as humans? You know, for example, these sorts of technologies don't just stand to improve our intelligence to, let's say, Einsteinian levels, where we are these mathematical, logical geniuses. These technologies, they have the potential to utterly transform what we are as humans and enter into the realm of the so-called post-human. In other words, this kind of entity that exists after humans. And at this point, I mean, we're talking thousands, if not even millions of times, you know, greater levels of capacity than current humans. So we have to ask ourselves right now, how will these technologies alter who we are as humans? In what ways could that be a benefit? In what ways could that be detrimental? So it opens up a whole, you know, whole area.